How are we all doing today? We're here at the Yankee Radio Network Fan Fest with a guy who's beloved by Met fans, beloved by Yankee fans, Darryl. That's all you need to say. What do you need to say his last name? Darryl, and you know who we're talking about. How you doing, man?
Doing great. How you doing?
How does it feel? Because there's very few guys that I think that can say this, that are beloved by Met fans and Yankee fans. You walk around the city, and Met fans are going to love you. They're going to talk about 86. Yankee fans love you. How does that feel to be loved by all of New York City in that way?
Well, it feels great when you play baseball in New York City and you have an opportunity to be an athlete in New York City and you're able to stand up and play behind the pressure, because there's a lot of pressure, there's a lot of media pressure to play here. And I think fans' expectations are real, and they let you know it. That's a good thing. I mean, go to other places and play, you don't have that problem. But, you know, playing in front of New York fans is great. It's the greatest fans that you will ever have an opportunity to play in front of.
Because I remember in the 30 on 30 with Doc, it was fascinating. One of the things you said is, like, you'd never even basically know where New York was when you heard you were drafted. When you first came to this city for the very first time, what was the experience?
I was shocked, you know, when I first got here. Just to see a place like this. I'm from Southern California, and I was born and raised there. Baseball was the Los Angeles Dodgers when I was born here. You know, of course, in Anaheim, they had the Angels there, but we never went that way. So I was really shocked, you know, what it was like in New York. And it was a great place, a great opportunity. People always ask me, would I do it all over again? I said, no, New York is the place. New York is home. New York sports is real. There's nothing greater than that. It's there. Like New York.
And we appreciate Mookie Wilson is joining us right now. Mookie, thank you very much. He's pitch hitting for Doc today. We appreciate you coming on and joining us today here at the Fan Fest. Nice to see you. Talk about a guy beloved here in New York City, Mookie Wilson. I was just asking Darryl about his first experience with this city. When you're drafted by the Mets in the late 70s and you finally make it up, I think late in the 1980 season, what was that first experience like being and playing in New York City?
Well, first of all, I didn't know who the Mets were, all right, when I was drafted, all right. Oh, where I live over here by the Atlanta Braves, so I didn't know the Mets were. I was surprised, shocked when the Mets drafted me. Still didn't know a lot about New York. I came up in 80, and no one could prepare me for what I was in for. I mean, we were sport fans in South Carolina, but New York's a different animal. It was a different animal altogether.
My first chant as a kid was "Mooey." It was "Mooing you." Now, the first time you got mooed, were you confused? Did you think you were being booed?
Well, no question. I'm definitely confused. You know, I mean, I've heard. Now, I don't know if you guys know the Mets back in the, you know, late 70s. They weren't very good. I mean, everyone got booed then. You went ballpark, and so it's a common thing to get booed. So. I thought you were booing me, but then I found out later that you were actually chanting my name, which made it easier on me.
When you're growing up, Darryl, was it baseball as your first love from the beginning, or were you wrestling with the idea of, hey, basketball is fun, football is fun?
No, it was actually football and basketball that I really liked more than baseball at the time. You know, but I played football and I played quarterback in high school, and I played on the junior varsity team in my first year. I got blindsided and hit, and I took the pads off and told them they could keep
it. That's a smart decision.
I was like, I'm not going to play. This is too physical. So, you know, I really stepped to the basketball court and got to the basketball. I mean, I had a scholarship to go to Oklahoma State to play basketball and baseball. But I realized that baseball was more of a one-on-one challenge, and I really wanted to play baseball because I like the challenge of an idea of a pitcher staring me down and me staring down with a bat in my hand. And I just thought, that was the ultimate dream, that I had the biggest advantage in that situation because I had the bat in my hand. That's the way it worked out for me.
What, do you ever think if I stuck with basketball, or even football, if you kept the pads on, that you could have made it to the NBA or the NFL?
I could have made it in basketball. I could have went to college and played college basketball and made it to probably the NBA. Yeah, no question about it. Because I was really just starting to develop in high school as a basketball player. And baseball, I was always raw in baseball. I always had the talent. I was never afraid to fail in baseball because I know baseball, the game of baseball, there's going to be a lot of failure in the game of baseball. And you have to understand, if you can accept that and accept the reality of that, then you can be the kind of players that we ended up being. Not afraid to play at that level, because you know the big league level is very challenging. You know, a lot of players can be good, but can they stand up and play at such a high level in front of people? And the ultimate dream is to get there, but you have to believe in yourself as a player. And I think a lot of times players don't believe in themselves. I see more guys that have more talent than me that have never believed in themselves and never made it.
How about you? Was baseball a first love right away?
No question. In my family, baseball was it. I mean, it's all we had. I mean, in South Carolina, do the football or baseball. I'm 5'10", so basketball is out of the question. I played a little football, but it just didn't give me the thrill. And I think I'm like a straw. I think it's the challenge of baseball. I mean, football, if you're faster than somebody, you're going to probably be successful. If you're bigger and stronger, you're probably be successful. And I just needed something that was going to challenge me as an athlete. And I think the one thing that drives us is that challenge that, you know, you might fail. And that, people say that might be funny, but it really is. It's always that next day. You never know what's going to happen. Without the challenge, most athletes are probably mediocre.
When did you, because you mentioned when you first joined the Mets in the early 80s, they were terrible. When did you see the change coming? Was when you laid eyes on Darryl? When did you feel this is going to change around here?
No, I'm going to tell you the truth. I saw a change coming in 83. The Mets had just brought a bunch of young guys, myself, Cubic Brooks, JSC. So we started to see that change. We were still losing, but we're in games. And sometimes it's not so much as whether you win or lose, it's how you win and how you lose. And I saw that change, and we began to really make strides. I started to feel good. My first year, I wanted to go back to the minor leagues, but I didn't know. We were winning down there, and we were having fun. We were already having fun in New York at that point. So 83 was when I saw the change, and organizations started to turn around.
How was that rookie season for you? Obviously, you won Rookie of the Year, but that adjustment, Darryl, from playing in the minor leagues, and now at such a young age, being in the majors.
Well, it was fun, because of the fact that I was in spring training that year with those guys, and I learned a little bit about the big league spring training and that year of 83 camp and everything. And then I went down to Tidewater and I started off in the Triple A and played a month down there, and then I got called up to the big leagues. And like Mookie said, we're a bad team, yeah. We're a last place team, but it was some things that you can see with young players and the development of the young players in the minor league system. We're starting to come and we're starting to arrive. And when you have that and knowing what we had in the minor leagues, the young pitching staff that we had with guys and some of the trades we made, Darling and Sid, they were there in the minor leagues, and you realized that these guys were going to be good. And you had Mookie and Hubie, and it was just a shift. It was a shift that started to change the organization with young players. And that's why you see so many clubs that end up being good, they develop young players. You have to develop young players. And that was the same thing with the Yankees. They developed their young players. When you develop your young players have a better chance of coming up to the major leagues and learning to play together, yes, and learning how to win. And I think that's what's important in baseball. And I think when you get away from that and you have too many veteran players and you don't have enough young players blending in, it's a real struggle, because veteran players have already been there for so long. So we had that in 83, yeah, and I was coming up and other guys were coming up. And before you knew it, we had a new manager and things were starting to chill.
That's what the Yankees are trying to do right now. That's why Yankee fans are actually excited, even though they may not go to the playoffs this year, because they're finally developing young players for the first time in a while. But needing that mix of veterans, what did Keith Hernandez do for that locker room and just for the whole team in general when he was brought in? You want to start?
I think that the move of getting Keith was something that we really needed. We had a lot of young players, and believe it or not, I was one of the older players at that time. But we needed someone who had been there, who understood that it's more than just physical ability. As Straw was saying, it's the ability to get up when you get knocked down. And Keith, was that one guy that we needed. We made some other moves, but the move that meant most to me into our organization with bringing in Keith Hernandez, because baseball, there's no guy smarter in the game than Keith Hernandez. He can just, he knows how to
get young players to stay in the game. And just by watching him, he wasn't a rah-rah guy, but he understood what every player needed, and he kept us motivated, kept us in the game. Pitch needed to be, you know, spoken to. He would run off first base, go to the mound, say a word or two. Actually, really didn't need a manager with Keith out there.
Yeah. You know, there are kids in the audience, so no specific story about the craziness of the locker room, but I am curious. I've always been curious. When did the locker room get crazy? Like, we always hear the legendary stories, like, was it overnight? Was it gradual? Like, at what point was it like, this place is crazy?
It was always crazy. He was just showing up to the ballpark every day. And, you know, once you got a group of guys like we had, and the personalities that we had, and, you know, you had guys like that was on the quiet side. It was like Gary Carter and Mookie Wilson. They were real quiet, and everybody else was like Animal House. You know, they just come to the ballpark. You never knew who was going to say what to the media. You never knew what was going to happen. You never knew who was going to be fighting inside the clubhouse over certain things, and, you know, but it was fun. That's what team is all about.
Well, I'll tell you, you know, as crazy as that team was, you know, I think that people misunderstand what that team was really all about. Yes, there was some craziness going on, but the thing that I loved about that team, and I played on a lot of baseball teams, but that is the best team I've ever played on, the best teammates I've ever played on, because when they came to the ballpark, it was all business. And this is one thing that I respect. Now, in saying that, you need all of that to make a team. You can't have everyone with the same personalities. It just don't work. You need the guys that are quiet and kind of introverted, and you need the guys that are not afraid to be themselves. You need those different personalities. You know, Wally, Nails, Straw, Dog, myself, Roger McDowell, Jesse, these guys, I'm telling you, all of them had personalities and they were different. And this is what made that team so special. How can that many personalities coexist? That would make that team special.
Yeah, it did. I mean, it really did, man. Just like Luke said, it was a special group of guys. And, you know, guys came to the ballpark every day. We believed in each other. And it didn't matter what other people thought about us. Everybody hated us around the league. We didn't care. We thought it was pretty cool that we came around the league. You know, but once we stepped between the lines, if you crossed our lines, you know, it was trouble. You know,
we saw that.
But that's just the way we were as a team. You know, that team. You know, and then when I think the big lift when we got Carter, when we got that right hand bat in our lineup.
Well, that helped because everybody, we had you, Wally, Keith, and
we needed balance, and we got Carter, and Carter came over, and that made a big difference. He had the pitching staff, and you know, that big right hand bat that we needed in the lineup, you know, just made a real big plus in what we were trying to accomplish.
Losing in 85, you know, having that final series in St. Louis, I don't mean to bring up bad memories, but I kind of look at it and say, maybe losing there helped you get stronger and win a title in 86. Do you look at it that way, that sometimes you have to have that defeat before you go all the way and win it all?
But it's, for me, I thought 84 is the year. 84 was the key year for me. 85, I was really disappointed that we didn't win it in 85. I thought that we had everything in place, you know, after coming off the 84, I thought 85. So 85 was... It was disappointing. It really was disappointing because I thought that we should have won it. And I think because of that disappointment, it made us more determined in 86.
Did you go into spring training knowing this is the year?
Well, I think 86, when we went into spring training after 85, like Luke said, we should have won. I think we just lost too many close games.
Yes.
Gave games away. 84, you know, we lost to the Cubs.
Yeah.
Because Sutcliffe came over and he went 16-1 for them, you know, so that was heartbreaking. And then 86, when we came back into spring training, you know, the first day of spring training, we had a meeting, and David Johnson, the meeting was to us that we're going to win it all.
Yeah.
We're going to dominate, we're going to win it all. We kind of looked around and we thought to ourselves, we're pretty good now, you know, we're going to win it all, you know. And we went into a series early in the season that year, 86. We went in and we swept the Cardinals.
Swept the Cardinals.
And Whitey Herzog came out publicly and he said, they're going to win it all. He said, that's the best team in the National League. They should win it all. And we ended up going on to win it all that year.
How difficult was it for you dealing with that eye injury in spring training, having to miss a significant amount of time?
Well, you know, I missed a lot of the fun in 86 of that spring because I did get hit in the eye, and I had other issues. I wasn't really concerned about winning it in 80, you know, in spring training. I just wanted to be able to play again, and that was my main concern. And it was tough. The first 2 months of the season was really, really tough. I didn't know which way this thing was going to go. But I thank God that, you know, I was able to come back and be there to perform and contribute in a big way in 86. And I think that's what makes 86 really special for me also, because there was a question whether I was going to even play or not.
I know it's been 30 years, but Mike Scott was scuffing the baseball. Are you 100% sure about that?
You know what? We just couldn't beat him. Bottom line, even though he was whatever he was, cheating or whatever, you know, everybody cheats. Everybody cheats. You know, you got guys in the Hall of Fame that's cheating.
They cheat.
It's the way sports is. You know, you learn how to cheat. You learn how to steal signs. You learn how to do this. You learn how to do that. You know, so that's just the nature of the business. It's who's going to learn the right way where you don't get caught, you know. And obviously Mike Scott knew how not to get caught, and he was cutting the ball up and the ball was moving and none of us could touch him, you know. I guess we made our mind up that we had to beat one of them, Scott or Ryan.
We had to be one of the two.
And we wasn't going to beat Scott, so we beat Ryan.
Yeah, so
we
took
Nolan Ryan. You know, and we ended up beating Nolan Ryan, so we knew we had to beat one of them.
Did you think part of it was him getting in your head too, Mike Scott? Like, do you think he was almost like, he was scuffing the bat. I think we all know that, like you said. Do you think it almost became mental at some point when you faced him?
No question. It's no question. As a matter of fact, I was saying to myself that game in Houston, I was saying, boy, we're going to win this game. Because the guys are already talking about game 7. We got to face Mike Scott. We don't want to do that. And it's not so much, you know, some of the key players are already thinking that. And once you get in your head about even doubts of beating someone, chances are he's probably going to beat you. But like Darryl said, there are a lot of guys that were scuffing the balls or using pine tar or nail files or whatever, but we had no problem beating those guys.
Right,
you know, it's just that he was up here. And I think the other thing made it different too is that Mike Scott was a man. He was one of us, and we all played with him in AAA. So I think they had a little more added incentive to it and the reason why we just felt that we couldn't beat him.
Was that game 6? The greatest game you ever played in?
Well, it was. It was the greatest game that you probably... You're talking about the National League Championship Series?
Yeah, the game in which if you didn't win, you're facing Mike Scott in game 7.
Yeah, that whole series was incredible. That was an incredible series. If you look back in that time and what baseball was really all about. And you didn't have wild cards. You had to win the division to get into the playoffs, and you had to win the National League Championship Cup. But that series against Houston was so draining for us.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, just going back and forth, you know, that game 6 was just like a nightmare.
It was.
You know, it was like a real nightmare, you know, going back and forth with the Astros, because, you know, we kind of knew on the other side that what they had.
We knew
they had Mike Scott. You know, we knew he was already in our head. We didn't really know if we could beat him or not. And we knew we needed to win that game. And, you know, we battled. We just kept battling. And, you know, that's the kind of team we had that year. That team was awesome. We won, 108 ball games?
Yeah.
You know, we would come back from games and like it was nothing, but we knew in game 6 of that, in game 6 of that National League Championship, we needed to win that.
Yeah.
There was no question about it.
My chest was hurting. My chest was so I'd say, man. You know, you ever get to a game that is so drained, you get 1 point and say, somebody win so we can just go home and start over again.
Right.
But we were to that point. You know, but as far as we knew, Houston had a good team going in. We knew they matched up well with us pitching. You know, they had speed, they had power, they had defense. But like Strauss said, if we could be one of those two guys, Nolan or Ryan, we were okay.
Do you think, because you talk about how draining that game was, that affected you at the beginning of the World Series, losing the first two games at Shea Stadium?
No question. I think that we were so mentally drained. And I think that once we beat Houston, we felt that Boston was going to be easy pick. In all honesty, I honestly believe that what happened, but when they knocked us in the mouth a couple of games and they woke us up.
Yeah.
Tougher pitcher to face, Roger Clemens, Nolan Ryan, Darryl.
I think Roger was easy to hit. He's had a straight fastball. Just throw a straight fastball. I don't know what about straight fastball. I turn the fastball around like it's nothing. But Nolan Ryan was a more difficult pitcher to base. Nolan Ryan was a guy that he had a different demeanor about himself. You know, when he looked mean, different. Man. Yeah, he was real mean on the mound. He wasn't like a guy that just looked. He just had this look. And you just knew that you better get in the box. You know, don't dig in, because he's gonna throw one on your chin. He's gonna knock you down or whatever he's gonna do, but he's gonna do it. And most other guys wasn't like that. And Nolan Ryan was very difficult. What about you?
Nolan Ryan, to me, people ask that question all the time, which pitcher I wanted to face the least? And Nolan Ryan, I mean, Nolan Ryan had great fastball, and he had a curveball that was unbelievable. So you really couldn't set him up. And if you did something he didn't like, he let you know. And I think
Robin Ventura knows about that really well.
Yeah, I wonder what possessed, I asked Robin about it, what possessed you to go out there?
What'd he say?
He said, Mookie, I had to go. I didn't want to, but I had to go. And sometimes you do that.
Nolan Ryan is a strong old Texas country boy. Man.
But I met him personally, one of the nicest men you ever want to meet. He was just on the mound, he was a different animal.
What was the mood going in 87? You win a championship. I mean, it doesn't get better than that. Was there that killer instinct in 87 in doing it again? What was the mood going into the year?
Well, we thought we were good enough going into 87, but what happened there was we lost our whole pitching staff. Everybody got hurt. You know, and injuries, you know, once injuries start to pile up on your team, it's difficult to be able to go back out and repeat like that when you had these same guys, because you can't just replace guys that's been in your rotation.
It just don't happen that easy.
It's very difficult to replace a rotation like that. And we had a great rotation, and we lost that rotation, and then it was very difficult for us to bounce back.
But on top of that, I thought, see, if people misunderstand that long as you have talent is that you should win, but baseball is different. Yeah. You need personalities. You need you need an attitude. We lost Kevin Mitchell. We lost Ray Knight, and we lost a big part of the pitching staff early. That was big. And I think the thing that hurt us the most was losing Kevin Mitchell. We don't lose Kevin Mitchell. I think it's a different 87. And we just lost our swag, for lack of a better term. And I think that was the beginning of it right there.
Did you get it back in 88? I mean, you guys had a great regular season. You dominated the Dodgers during the regular season. Was there that 86 feel in 88 with that swagger back?
88 was a good team. 88 was a great team. We should have won that year, you know, I think. But I guess the Dodgers, you know, I think they got a little charged up when Coney started writing columns about them and calling them little leagues. And, you know, went all through their clubhouse, you know, because we killed them during the regular season. And, you know, Doc had 0-2 on John Shelby and walked him. Socia comes up, hits a home run, you know, that he would never hit off Doc, you know. And it just broke our back, you know. There's just certain things that broke our back in that season. And we went into that Game 7 at Dodger Stadium, and, of course, we should have. I thought Sid Fernandez should have been the starter, but Dolly was the starter, and they jumped out on us right away, and it was hard to come back in, you know. And that 88 team's good. Coney pitched Game 6, but Coney pitched a great game in Game 6 for us, and then we came back Game 7, and Dolly was starting Game 7, and we was facing Hershiser, and he was having such a great year.
Yep.
They go on to beat us. They go on to beat that Oakland A's team that year, you know. You know the story from there with Gibson with the big home run, and you know, they go on to win the World Series that year. So I guess it was just meant to be for the Dodgers that year.
And I think a lot of Met fans look back and say the biggest mistake is they should have re-signed Darryl Strawberry. And I'm sure you would have loved to have stayed in New York a lot longer. When did you see the handwriting on the wall that, for whatever reason, Frank Cashman didn't want you back? Because I think he's the guy to blame for this whole thing. When did you sense, I'm not going to be back with the Mets, I'm going to be somewhere else?
But you know what happened was I saw that they were making changes, and they were starting to change, trade players and get rid of players. Well, you know, Mookie was gone. They traded Lenny to Philly for Juan Samuel, and I was like, and they traded Roger. I was like, man, they went in a different direction. You know, we traded all the guys that were here that played and, you know, that had guts. You know, because it takes guts to play in New York. I mean, you can't just run out there on the New York team and play and not have enough guts to, you know, be able to play the game the right way. And I think that's what happened. When I saw that, I realized that it was time for me to get out of here. I realized that things were going in a different direction, and, you know, it was time for me to move on from the Mets.
Where were you looking at? Was it L.A.? Were there any other potential options for you?
Yeah, I mean, Seattle was coming after me. I was thinking, I'm not going to go play in Seattle. You know, it's like, I played in New York all my life. Why would I want to go to Seattle? But, I tell you what, I learned later on when I became a Yankee, had not George been suspended that year,
he told me
he would have signed me. I was a free agent. You know, but he was suspended. He was out of baseball.
Yeah.
And he had sat down and told me, you know, had I not been in trouble and suspended when you became a free agent, that was the year I became a free agent. And, you know, he got suspended and he was out of baseball. But I was, you know, it was between Seattle and a couple other teams in L.A. and I just ended up going to L.A.
I remember, and if I'm wrong, correct me, Mookie, like early April, an exhibition game at Shea Stadium when the Blue Jays came to Shea Stadium.
Yeah.
And the place went nuts for you. I remember because I was standing up screaming on the top of my chair for you. How was that? I know it's an exhibition game, but getting to return as a Blue Jay to the team that drafted you, the team you played so long with.
It was a lot of fun. I didn't know how I was going to react. I didn't know how the fans were going to react either. Because, you know, when I left the Mets, I really didn't leave.
I didn't want to say it that way on that.
Nobody needs no good terms.
You know, we weren't exactly having dinner together when I left for that.
Who needs the Mets on good terms? Does that happen?
It was one of those things where it was good for me because it was evident that the Mets were going in another direction. You see, they brought Juan Samuel in to play center field, who was a second baseman.
Go figure. But. That's logic.
Yeah, man. You know, but I kind of figured that out. So, I actually welcomed the trade when it came about. But when I got the chance to come back to New York, you know, I've had so much fun here, played in the city. I've had such a great relationship with the fans, you know, and the people in New York. That they come back, I didn't feel like I was on the opposite team. I really did. It felt like I was just playing in front of. The fans have always supported over the years, and I've enjoyed it. Toronto is a beautiful place to play, but when I signed to play in Toronto, I told them I'm gonna play for you and I'm gonna put you hard, but I'm gonna always be a Met. It's one thing I've always told.
How was that return for you? It was definitely like an event, that's for sure. People holding up signs and whatnot. That first game back at Shea Stadium as a visiting player.
Oh, it was pretty cool. It was crazy, you know, as I expected it to be. Me returning there and playing against the team that drafted me, going through the minor league system and just being a homegrown player. It's nothing like being a homegrown player and going through an organization and learning the organization, and that's what it was for me. And I know my return was more of like a Zoom, you know, because everybody was like wanted to see me because I moved all the way out west after playing 8 years here, and then I go all the way west. And It was kind of heartbreaking to leave. It's heartbreaking to leave the city because I love New York City. I love New York sports. I love New York fans and what it's all about. You know, when you learn to play underneath that, there's nothing greater than that. I've been everywhere and I played everywhere and I saw I went out to LA. The fans were like so laid back and I was like, oh my God, I didn't sign up for this. You know, it's like. New York fans were like real. They come to the ballpark. See, LA fans come to the ballpark. They come late and they leave early. But New York fans come early and they stay late.
That's right.
So
that's right.
It was a big difference. It was a big difference in my playing, you know, in front of New York fans, you know, because they're there. They're at the ballpark. And the greatest thing about playing in front of the New York fans, what I love about them more than anything, is they let you know when you suck.
Oh, yeah.
You know? That's a good thing. I used to love that when I was playing over in Queens. They let me know when I suck. I used to go down.
Really?
To
you like getting booed occasionally?
I love getting booed because I used to go down to the dugout and say, I'm going to hit two off the scoreboard and I'm going to come. They want me to come out for a curtain call. And I ain't coming out for no curtain call. So it was like a little game, you know, it was like a little game we played, you know. But it was real cool to be able to play that game with our New York fans because it's just something special. It's something great about New York fans. It just make you believe in yourself. I mean, across the board, even. When I came over to the Yankees, you know, the Yankee fans treated me so great in the Bronx, you know, and putting on the pinstripes, and they just made me feel like family, you know, and I'll never forget that. I'll never forget what that feeling was like, and playing in front of them is there's something different about playing in front of New York fans.
We love you, too.
Yeah, I love you. I got to give this compliment to Yankee fans, because I really do believe this.
Yeah.
We as Met fans, when we bring over a former Yankee, we're almost like, he's a, like, we're having a tough time accepting them. And I think, especially with you, when George brought you back, it's almost like Yankee fans liked you from the beginning. It wasn't this, he's a Met. He wouldn't, and I don't know what the difference is. I can't figure it out. But did you sense that? Like, right out of the gate, instead of some Yankee fans saying, he's Darryl Strawberry. You know, he's a Met. It's almost like they accepted you from the beginning. Did you sense that?
You have to understand when you put on a Yankee uniform, you're part of the Yankee family. You know, the Yankee organization is a very prideful organization and a very good organization, very classy organization. And George loves his players, and he makes people love his players. He makes Yankee fans love his players. I don't know about them how they are now. It's a different breed now because George is no longer here. But when you play for him, you know, his idea was winning. It wasn't about what everybody else thought. It wasn't about what the media thought. Yeah, some fans are going to dislike you, but he didn't really care. If you can go out there and you can help them win, that's all that was really important. He was about winning. And when you get an owner that's about winning, I think that sometimes people were ungrateful. The media was ungrateful for George, you know, but when you get an owner that's all about winning and bringing players in to make his ball club better, that's what baseball is all about. And that's what happened with those Yankee years for me. I ended up going over there with Joe Torre, and you know, they had veteran players, but they had good young players coming up, Sala, Jeep, Mo. These guys were multi-talented, and you knew they were going to be great, you know, and you blend in with veteran players, and that's how that 96 team became so good, you know, because George went out and got players like me, Cecil, he brought Charlie Hayes, he brought other players to come in to play roles, and Joe uses, he had a bench of players that had experience, and that's what baseball is about. If you don't have a team that don't have experience, you're not going to win. You know, those Yankee years were great because we had team over there, we had teams over there that had experience and also had young players on the rise.
You, Mookie, were managed by a young Joe Torre, right?
Yeah.
Could you sense back then that, hey, this guy's got a chance to be an all-time great Hall of Fame manager?
Let's call it for what it is. Joe had no chance. And it had nothing to do with Joe.
Right.
They were just a bad team. Great guys, just a bad team. And I spoke with Joe a couple weeks ago, as a matter of fact. And, you know, who would have thought that Joe would end up being in the Hall of Fame, you know, and win as many games as he did? Because, you know, like Darryl said, it's all about the players. If you don't have the players, I don't care who you are. I don't care what manager you are. You're not going to win. You're not going to win. The one thing I did like about Joe being a former player in the major leagues and probably had a struggle of his own, he understood that. And he always tried to put his players in a position to perform. And I've always admired Joe for that. I had the pleasure of playing on him for a couple of years. And I think we've remained friends over the years, even when he was managing with the Yankees and stuff. So we've done a couple of things together. And it couldn't happen to a greater guy.
Yeah.
We're going to have a Q&A with Darryl and Mookie, so we'll take your questions coming up. What was the conversation like when George approached you about possibly joining the New York Yankees? What was that initial conversation like?
Well, I think it was more of a, like, he wanted to put it in the Mets' face. You know, more than
anything. Did he tell you that? Was he blunt about that?
Yeah, somewhere between me and him. You know, I clearly understood, you know, that he wanted to show them, you know, that, you know, I can bring him here and he can help us over here. You know, and they definitely put it in their face. And, you know, I'm always grateful for George because, you know, he's not a person that most people see as someone who has an open heart to do things for people, but he's done so many wonderful things, not only for me and my family, but just for all kind of people down in Tampa and children for the hospital, stuff that they never talk about, you know. And, you know, he took it personal with having me come over to play for the Yankees, and I'll never forget that. I will always be grateful. You know, he's a man of true character and integrity, and I will always respect him for that. And, you know, having conversations with him, I think that's why I'm such a great man today in what I do, because me and him had conversations about life and challenges, and he taught me some things, and, you know, it's played out in my life today. That's why I help so many people, because I never forget this man helped me. So he's taught me about what it is to go back and reach down and help somebody else. And you know, that's what life is all about. You know, people only look at him because he was a Yankee homer and a billionaire and everything, but his heart for people was greater than who he was as a Yankee owner and a billionaire.
That's funny. I think Met fans wonder what would have been like if you re-signed with the Mets. It was interesting when you brought up how George told you, hey, if I wasn't suspended, I would have signed you. Do you wonder how different your career could have been if you went from the Mets to the Yankees and never had that pitch stop in L.A.?
Oh, yeah. That little small ballpark in Yankee Stadium, I would have killed it. I didn't realize how small that right field line was. I wish I would have known that. I wish we'd have played on there more often. We only played there, I think, one time. And I hit a ball off the Dave LaPointe up in the top, up top deck in the game. But I didn't realize how short that fence was in the right field. I would have killed that fence. I didn't think about it.
So how many home runs would help, you thinking? 600, 700? What are you thinking?
Oh, my God. In that little ballpark, I mean, I'm probably going to hit 50 a year in Yankee Stadium. You know, it's just so small. You know, it's just like, for me, you know, it was different. It was just like hitting the ball in the bleachers over there. You know, it's like nothing. That's a great ballpark to hit in.
How many would you have hit, Mookie? Would you got the 20, 25, 30? What are you thinking?
I think I'm maxed out at 10 one year, and I probably would hit three more.
When did you get the sense, Darryl, about that 96 team being special? You joined them, I guess, a couple of months into the year. I'm trying to remember. I know you played with the St. Paul Saints for a while. Hit like 490, which was absurd, putting those numbers up. When you rejoined the Yankees in 96, did you get the sense from the beginning, this is special? I know it's special, this is special.
Well, I knew they had a good team. You know, when you joined that team and you looked all around the field, they had every position player that was very solid, you know, at that point. You had a young G that's short. You had a veteran, Dunk at second. You know, you had Boggs over there at third, and you had Chino, and then you had the outfield. And you had, you know, O'Neal and Bernie. So you pretty much sat there. You had a young catch, you had Girardi was a catcher, and you know, and you had a left field open, and you brought players in to fill in, and then you brought players in to come off the bench, and the depth on the bench was what was the difference in that 96 team. But when you look at that 96 team, when we got in the World Series, we went down 0-2 immediately. Andrew Jones killed us 2 games. It was like, oh my God, you know, we're behind, you know. So Joe Torre decided, well, you know what? I got a veteran bench. We go down the line and you play those. And then we go on to win, you know, we go on to win some big games. You know, we got Baltimore in that series, you know, I mean, the playoff series, I mean, with Baltimore.
Yeah, the ALCS. Yeah, we beat up Jeffrey Mayer series, I guess, is what it's called.
Yeah, we beat up on Baltimore, and then we go on into the World Series, and we down, and then we go down to the line. But the key was having good pitching. You know, we go down the line and, you know, unbelievable 1-0 shutout ball game. That was incredible. I mean, this had a line team, you know, and that was a real turning point for us. You know, when we got down there and played those games down there, and then we came back and we finally won it. But you know, Joe Torre was, like Luke said, he was a man that was put in the right position with the right players, and he was very personal about his players, you know, which I love about him. You know, he never threw his players under the bus and never talked to his players about the media. He just kept it in house. And he knew how to mix and match. You know, sometimes managers don't. Managers have players, and they don't even know how to use them. And he knew how to use his players, and I think that's why that run became that run, because he knew the talent that he had, and he knew how to use it.
How would you look back at Mookie with Davey and the way he managed that mid-'80s team, the 86 team? I guess the sense is he was a player's manager, obviously, but was he the perfect guy for that team?
Yeah, I think Dave was the perfect guy for that team, because you had to be very tolerant because of the personalities. And I think that you couldn't be a manager that went by the book, that always tried to be so correct in everything you say and everything you do, because that wouldn't have worked with that club. That was a club that you had to let be themselves. And Dave wasn't afraid to let the club be themselves. He got criticized for it a lot. And some people even say that is the reason why we didn't win 87, 88, but that's not the case. I think Davey was the perfect manager for that club. Where does he rank in all the managers? I wouldn't know, because that club was, how do you say it, it was auto. You just put players out there and push them and let them go. That's what that team was. Like we knew what we had to do. We had Keith, we had Gary, and we had Straw. We had a couple of years now under his belt. Pitching staff got the veteran pitching staff. You know, just let us know when we're going to play and the bench. Straw mentioned that. People don't understand the bench is so important. We had, people don't realize we had four positions that we platooned. Four positions.
That's amazing.
And to be able to do that, and he was able to mismatch it. So we didn't always like it because everybody wanted to play every day, but he understood that, and we got playing time, and we were successful.
That 1998 team you played on, for my mom, I mean, it's the greatest team I've ever seen. Do you feel that about that team? Because there was a game, I think it was in Oakland, where the Yankees are losing like 7-0. I think you're the guy with the grand slam to tie the game. And it was one of those games I was watching as a fan saying, this team won't lose. They're a machine. Even when you think they're going to lose, they're going to win. And obviously, you rattle off all those victories and win the World Series. That 98 team.
Well, 98 was a great team. There was no question about it. I mean, I think that year, every time we got on the field, we just knew we could win. It didn't matter if we were behind or what it was. You know, it just didn't matter because you had a group of guys that just understood what it takes to win. You know, there was no selfishness. You know, players were like willing to sacrifice. Didn't matter who get the job. I think a lot of times when you find teams, they depend on one or two players. But on that team, you know, it was just didn't matter who got the job done that night, who was the hero. You know, and when you look at that 98 Yankee team, you think about a guy named Scott Brosius. No, nobody would ever think about, but
right.
He was like so big that whole year. You know, every time you looked around that year, you know, he was doing something. You know, I played that year and I ended up with cancer that year. I ended up hitting 24 home runs that year playing and coming off the bench and hit that grand slam in Oakland that year. And just that group of guys, you know, the way they approached the game, it was remarkable because we had a lot of fun. We had a lot of fun winning. We had a lot of fun kicking butt and taking names. You know, it just didn't really matter for that 98 Yankee team.
So now I'm curious. Best of seven, 86 Mets, 98 Yankees. How does that series look?
Oh, boy.
I'm all... Yeah, look. I'm gonna tell you. I respect the Yankees team. I respect all of you. All right, but that '86 team was something special, man. I mean, we weren't short in any position. Usually, you can see, well, we got one area right here, and it's not so much as that the starting nine, it's that we had guys that could fill in. Hey, I gotta stick my Mets. I'm sorry.
I think a woman was screaming out that Darryl, you're on both teams. How does he play on both teams? Look, this series is unrealistic anyway. I mean, it can't happen. What would you say?
That's a head-to-head series.
Yeah.
You know, no question about it. The difference is, I think the '86 Mets, the '96 Yankees was a great team, and you know, great organization where we run it. And, I don't think they would ever beat the 86 Mets because the 86 Mets didn't drink milk. We drank alcohol. So we were a different team. We were a different personality. We didn't want to encounter with us. We were a different bunch of guys. You know? And the 98 Yankees were the team that drank milk a lot. You know? They were good boys. You know? They would have had a real tough time beating us because you know, the guys we had on our team liked to fight. And the pitchers we had on our team would love to drill you.
Yeah.
That was one thing about.
Though I do remember now you were involved in it, that amazing brawl with the Orioles where Armando Benitez.
Oh, yeah.
So we all hate it. Look, we're universal. It's okay. Yankee fans, Mets fans were united on that. He drills Tino. I mean, 99 mile an hour fastball in the back, and you, Graham Lloyd too, but you were ready to go.
Well, you know, I mean, he looked over in our dugout and told us to come. It was like. That was the wrong thing to do, was to look in our dugout and tell us to come, you know. So he looked in the dugout and told us to come. Guess what? I came, you know. And Graham Lloyd and all of us, we came. We just, you know, we really realized that we needed to do. I mean, Bernie had just hit a grand slam, and Tino gets the first pitch right between the numbers, you know. And I know it. I mean, that pitch could have killed him, you know. But we realized, I think he realized that he made a big mistake when he called us out. You know, that was it. Once he called us out, we were gone.
I remember Yankee Stadium had that beam issue or something like that where something was falling. So you had to play a game at Shea Stadium against the Angels. I think you hit one off the scoreboard as a Yankee. Was that surreal playing as a Yankee, especially for you? Grew up as a Met, your home games are at Shea Stadium, and now your next life as a Yankee, you're hitting a bomb of a home run as a Yankee at Shea Stadium.
No, it's not surreal. I mean, you think about it. A lot of times we look over that and you look over the fact, yeah, of course I played for the Mets, but and I went to the Yankees and I played most of my career at the Mets. I don't even like the Mets. You know, I don't like the organization. And, you know, I don't deal with them. I like the Yankee organization. I like the Yankee fans. I like Mets fans. Don't get me wrong. But I'm just speaking about organization wise.
We can't argue with you. I mean, I'm a Mets fan about arguing with you.
No, I'm just being honest. I'm being honest about the organization. You know, it's a big difference in playing an organization that really appreciates the fact that you're part of the organization. But the Mets organization never appreciated the fact that the players they had and who we were. So, you know, that's their problem. They need to deal with it. That's why they haven't won in the 30 years. Hey, it is what it is. I don't need them. I don't need them. And I hope they feel the same about me. They don't need me. I don't need them. So,
Mookie, your thoughts?
Well, listen, you asked y'all how you feel. I mean, I know he probably didn't feel any different when he hit the ball off the scoreboard. He did it so many times. So it's one same thing. It's not like, well, he's the first person to hit it up there. He went off the scoreboard quite a few. Matter of fact, he might have his initials up there. I don't know, but anyway. But, you know, there is something special about when you come back and visit a team and you do well. But as far, I've only played for two clubs. I played 10 years of my career with the Mets and 2 years with Toronto. And I'm still employed by the Mets. I cannot say we haven't had our issues because we have. We have. But, you know, I love New York. And, you know, this is all I know. It really is all I know. People ask me many times if I had an opportunity to go someplace else, would I? Not at my age, I'm not going anywhere. It's too old to start all over again, folks. I'm not starting over again. And but it's great. We've had our issues, but I think that there's some things that goes beyond what you feel personally. And I will never turn my back on New York, regardless of what personal things I'm going through, because I've had such a good time.
We'll take some of your questions. I have a little Q&A with Mookie and Darryl. See who we have first up here.
Can we get your comments on Alex Rodriguez's career?
Yeah, I mean, Alex is a tremendous baseball player. Regardless of whatever, you know, has happened, you know, for him, you will probably never see players like him and Barry Bonds ever again. The way they played it and what they've accomplished. And so that's what I really think about him. And I wish him well. I wish him well in all that he does moving forward. But as far as Alex Rodriguez being a baseball player, I've never seen one better. The talent that he has displayed in his career and everything, you're not going to see players like that for a very long time.
Do you ever think, because Barry Bonds started using steroids because he saw the popularity of other guys and said, hey, I'm better than these guys. Ever think of how many home runs you hit if you used any kind of PED, any extra help like some of these guys in the late 90s had?
I mean, you know, I didn't need it, you know.
That's the perfect answer.
I mean, how far do you want to hit the baseball? I mean, come on, a home run is a home run, yeah. You know, that's what people need to understand. I don't think a lot of times guys misunderstood that fact that a home run is just a home run. But when you see a second baseman that only hit 10 home runs and he comes and hit 50, then you know something's wrong.
Thinking of a few guys in my head right now, actually.
Go ahead. Davey Johnson.
Hey guys, first off, you both look great. I'm glad everybody's doing well. What road city did you like going to the most where you wanted to stick it to the fans just the most?
Cardinals.
Oh man, the Cardinals. I have to agree. And it was a great love-hate relationship with the Cardinals. You know, they were the team that was just a thorn in our side, and we were the same with them. And our team was constructed to beat them, and their team was constructed to beat us. I mean, I remember Whitey started three lefties out of the bullpen one game just to beat us because we're left-handed dominant, and that's what he did. That's the kind of but the Cardinals, you know, and the other team, a close second would be Chicago. Because, man, I'm telling you, boy, because you go there, it's a great place to play, and the fans are relentless. But they're good fans. They're great fans.
They're not like Boston fans. Boston sucks. They're fans. No, really. They're the worst. You know, the Boston fans are the worst, the Boston fans, you know. It's like, because they're right on top of you. They go to that ballpark, they're right on top of you, and they just, the things that they say is just like, oh my God. You know, you just can't believe what they talk about. They talk about your mama, they talk about your kids, they talk about everybody, you know. It's just like, it's like amazing, you know, because we hate Boston anyway, period.
So your first year with the Yankees, Darryl, was 95. That was also Madden his last year. So, but like, just point out, what was your first experience? What was your favorite moment that year? Like, as you saw, like, a great Yankee legend retiring. What was your feelings about that?
Well, Donnie, man, Donnie baseball was the greatest. You know, I think a lot of people, he missed the boat of being on the championship teams, but I've known him for a very long time because I was playing on the other side, and we would always run into each other at the All-Star games and stuff, and we were both highly New York guys, and just the friendship, just to know him personally, you know, he's such an amazing dude, more than just being a baseball player, and I know what all the great things that he accomplished as a Yankee, I mean, will always go down in history. He probably should go down as one of the greatest Yankees of all time, you know. I think a lot of people underestimate who Donnie really is.
Okay, I have a question for both of you. What is your favorite year as a ball player when you play baseball?
Favorite year?
Our favorite year? My favorite year was, I have to say, your first year is always your best because you're excited, you're young, you think you're on top of the world, and you finally have accomplished something in all those years of riding buses, you know, and I'm told when I ride, if you survive the minor league, you deserve to celebrate when you get that first year. And so my first year, I have to say, is my most memorable year because some unusual things happened. So I have to say my first year, which was my rookie year was 81.
I would have to say 86, and when we clinched the National League Championship, you know, I'll never forget that because, you know, I grew up watching baseball and I always wanted to be a baseball player, and I always saw baseball teams play and play World Series and see players lose, and you see other players. The winning team, then you see players on the other side, the loser side,
crying.
Yes. But it's real. I mean, it's just so real, you know. And I was thinking, you know, that year when we clinched against the Cubs, and all the fans ran on the field at Shea Stadium, and you couldn't get off the field. That's what baseball is all about. That's what I remember more than anything. I always looked at that and I said, man, one day I hope I could be in that position right there, and I could do that. I could see the fans come.
Favorite Yankee year?
Yeah, your favorite Yankee.
All of them. Because we were winning, you know.
You didn't have down years with the Yankees.
Yeah, it was good coming to the ballpark playing for the Yankees.
Hey, Darryl, I want to know what was going through your head when Joe Torre said, we're going to sweep them on the road to then see Jim Leyritz's game time home run.
Well, that 96 series was amazing. We got down 0-2. You know, we rode into that series on a high note because we had just beat Baltimore in that series, I believe, and we had everything clicking, and then we go open up the World Series, and I just think not only was the fans shocked, but we were shocked as a team when we were down 0-2, and then George was so cool, you know, he was like really cool. He came in the clubhouse, he wasn't acting crazy, he was just like, we're gonna go down and we're just gonna win, and we'll just win it all, and we have to come back home. And, you know, that was really cool to be able to see that from him. And when we went down there, you know, we just went down there and we played baseball. You know, we played good baseball, but the key for us was we got great pitching in that series when we got into Atlanta. And that was the key that turned the whole thing around for us. And and we got back in it, and then we came back home and won it. So, you know, it was just a great run for that 96 team. And, you know, we just celebrated the 20-year anniversary. It was great to see all the guys that we all, you know, they were all back. Everybody was just, like, really happy, you know, about the fact that we that we accomplished that.
Hi, guys. Thanks for coming here. I wanted to know, what were your feelings on how Davey Johnson's tenure with the Mets ended? And do you think your careers with the Mets would have been extended if he had been retained as manager?
It's really difficult to answer that. I was gone a couple of years before that, and I think you were already gone before that. So we don't know what transpired between management, upper management. We don't know. But if Davey had stayed, it wouldn't have made a difference. It really wouldn't have made a difference. We were already gone. So I don't think that would have made a difference. I think that things happen between management that stays between management, and they don't let the players in on this. But it wouldn't have made a difference. I think the ties and the change is already in progress. And so and Davey was probably the last piece that had to go.
Hello. Which ballpark do you guys like better, City Field or the current
City Field?
Why is that? Because that stadium would be perfect for you as a ball player, right?
No, I say that, and I'm not saying that in a malicious way. I had the pleasure of going to Yankee Stadium, the new one, and it's a beautiful ballpark. But City Field is much different. It is a much different ballpark. I'm in City Field a lot, and I get a chance to walk around and see the game from every angle of that ballpark. My feet hurt walking that place so much, matter of fact. And there really is, they really designed that ballpark to be fan friendly. It really is. And I know they had the same intentions when they did Yankee Stadium, but I think they did a much better job in accomplishing that at City Field.
Yes, I'd like to thank both of y'all for coming. This is for you, Darryl. What gave you the motivation to say, like, if a child wants to become a baseball player, what's the motivation to keep them focused on doing what they got to do to become a player?
Well, I think the motivation for any kid is not to let anyone else dictate how good you are. And I think sometimes too many people want everybody else to dictate how good you are and tell you what, because they told me I wasn't that good, you know. But they turned out to be liars, right? I made them liars, you know. A lot of them said you wasn't gonna be that good, you know. And that's a lot of times what happens to kids. They get told, well, you can't do this, you can't do that. Well, that's the same thing they told me when I first started playing baseball. You know, I was slow, I couldn't run. It was like, you're this and that. And I just kept going. I kept pursuing my dream. And I think the kids have to learn that, you know. You don't need affirmation from anyone else. You need it from yourself. You need to tell yourself how good you are. You know, I used to look in the mirror, and I used to go to the ballpark by myself and run the bases by myself. I talked to myself and told myself how good I was. I think a lot of times people need looking for coaches. Coaches are great, don't get me wrong. My coaches were like hard on me. They used to like have to drag me out of the bed to go to practice. You know, that wasn't coming. But I got to a place where I got motivated myself. I started believing in myself how good I could be.
Well, on top of that, the other thing is, I understand what Star is saying, because I was told I was too small. You know, I was too small. I could run, I could do all those things, but you're just too small. I was 140 pounds coming out of high school. you can't let that deter you. You know, you just have to understand who you are and what your talents are, and try to really maximize your strength. And my strength was my being able to run. And I wasn't gonna let anything stop me from using that on the baseball field, on both sides, defensively and offensively. So that's the advice I would tell them. Know who you are, you know, and encourage yourself. Don't rely on other people to motivate you. Right. You have to motivate yourself. If you rely on other people to motivate you, you're probably gonna be in trouble.
Thanks, folks, guys, for coming. Darryl, I have a question for you. In the 30 for 30 document, you talked a little bit about your relationship with George Steinbrenner, and it seemed to be kind of a special relationship. Could you just tell us a little bit more about what George did for you in your life and your career as a Yankee?
Yeah, it was very personal. George was like a father that I've never had. And I think sometimes people don't know when, you know, they look at athletes and people, and they don't know where they come from, and they don't know the dysfunction of their life. I didn't have a father. So George became that father I never had. You know, he was the one that set me down and says, you know, you belong in New York. You know, everybody's falling short. Everybody makes mistakes in life. And, you know, it doesn't mean you're a bad person. You know, I think sometimes we look at people and we look at their mistakes and we think they're bad people. You know, that's not the case. And, you know, that was the case with George, sitting with him and just telling me, you know, telling me about the Yankee family and what it means to put on the pinstripes and play for him. And once I realized that, you know, he was a real person, he wasn't one of these owners that was holding stuff over your head. You know, a lot of times in sports, owners say, well, owners are all about the business. I want to win, yeah. And they hold stuff over players' head. But George wasn't like that. You look at some of the players and the personal players that he dealt with, and I found out, you know, why he was so, always had so much passion about, you know, people that had struggles with addiction, you know, drugs and alcohol, because I realized that he had lost a young nephew or something. Oh, he got something, how his brain got some story, because it was such a struggle. He had so much passion to help the people in that area because he believed that, you know, people lives matter. And I think that's what a lot of other people criticize. Why they criticize it, once you go to the root of the problem and look at somebody's history before you criticize it. George was that person that would always straighten the media out about a person, and you don't know what a person's going through.
Hey, Darryl, Mookie, one question. How did you know your talents lied in baseball?
You know, baseball is such a difficult sport to play, and we all played it. You know, when you're in high school, you could run faster, you'd probably be the best player or play shortstop. But you really don't ever know. You just have to keep playing at the next level. You never know. Even my last day, I was nervous before every game I ever played in Major League. I was nervous before every game because I always knew there was a chance that I could fail. But being able to accept that challenge, yeah, you know, is what makes. So you never really know when you're good enough. You just keep trying to get better every day. The person that says, okay, I'm good enough to play here now, that person probably not going to play there because he's become satisfied, I've made it, I've accomplished. You have to accomplish things until you had a career, and at the end, now we can look back, you know, and say, I can look back now and I can honestly say, I never got to the point where I felt like I had it made. Never got to that point.
That's good. That's good. Me personally, I was just crazy. Yeah, I had a crazy personality. I had a crazy mind. I never thought about what nobody said over me on the baseball field, because I knew when I stepped between the lines, I could crush the baseball. That was the bottom line. It didn't matter what anybody else was thinking, what they were talking about, what they were writing about. It didn't matter to me. I said, when I got on that field, it's on. You know, that you off the field is a different story, but on the field, it was on.
Hi, Mookie, this is for you. I want to know why the Mets organization does not value speed, and is there anybody young coming up that has any?
Well, I'm going to say something here, and I might get shot for it. Not just, but, you know, but it, baseball hasn't changed. The culture of the game is changing. People are starting to demand different things from their players, and as they do that, they forget about one valuable asset that has always been in baseball, and that is speed. Look across all of Major League Baseball, there's just not many people that run anymore. Now guys lead the league stealing 50 bases. I stole 50 and was like 15th or 20th in the league. You know, so that just is not a valuable tool anymore. Let's face it, people love the long ball. People want to see the ball go out of the ballpark. And you don't think that management sees this? So they try to bring guys in to hit the long ball. And so you don't see the speed anymore. So it's not that they don't value it, it's just that the fans haven't demanded it yet. They're, you know, so when fans start demanding that they want to see speed, then you start seeing it. When players start seeing that it's a reward in their speed, then you start seeing guys run more. Right now, reward is in long ball. So that's what you're looking for.
Yeah. Billy Hamilton's like the only guy left. Give these guys a hand, they did an excellent job. Darryl Strawberry, Mookie Wilson. Thank you.